Welcome, everyone, to the LNP Opinion Forum, Diversity and Free Speech on Campus. We thank our host, Millersville University, for the use of this wonderful facility, Steinman Hall. My name is Suzanne Cassidy. I'm LNP's opinion editor, and I'll be moderating our discussion tonight with LNP's deputy editor, Rich Minieri. We are happy to be joined by representatives from 7 local colleges: Millersville University, Elizabethtown College, Franklin and Marshall College, Harrisburg Area Community College's Lancaster campus, Lancaster Bible College, Lancaster Theological Seminary, and Thaddeus Stevens College of Technology. The participants who are with us tonight were selected by their colleges. As a news organization championing the First Amendment, we ardently defend the right of students on campus to have their concerns heard, and we ardently defend the rights of faculty to teach challenging ideas. Tonight, we hope to take some of the heat out of this heated subject, so we can discuss speech on campus, on college campuses, in a forthright, civil, and productive way.
It's a little problematic, because I think one way to advance our society and address the issue about racism, sexism, and homophobia is allow people to really speak freely and to be able to engage their real thoughts and feelings about these issues. Because some of us walk around on eggshells all the time, trying to figure out the right terms, the right way. We don't want to make mistakes. And part of the problem is that we actually don't engage in constructive conflict. We used to be talking at each other and through each other, but aren't able to talk about our biases, our prejudices, you know, the ways in which we struggle around issues, because we're in a context where somebody like me, I'm not gonna put my name in this time, where we might challenge you because you're not using the right word. Don't call me him. I'm gonna be referred to as her or so many things. I'm African American or I'm black. And so that makes sometimes people don't wanna be a part of it. So we have a lot of fear about diversity engagement.
They try to accommodate students with an individual case, and something that may offend one student may not offend the other. So that's where it becomes difficult. And then again, things that we might take that when we want to say something political or in any formal way, we take it personal. Mm-hmm. And there's a fine line between something being a belief and something being a fact.
I think that, you know, when marginalized group of students especially ask for these safe spaces, that it's not, you know, it's not to exclude per se, but instead to internally build, to create and establish their own voice in the community.
What I think, and what I've seen the trend over the last couple of years, is that safe space has moved for many, in many cases, beyond those types of support groups you're talking about, to the entire campus. And to me, the most poignant current example of this is from the 9/11 weekend over at Occidental College in California, where the College Republicans got permission to put 3,000 flags up on the quad the Saturday night before 9/11. They found many of them were thrown in the garbage the next day, and there were many posters talking about Iraqi war casualties and things like that. And later that week, a student group who supported, didn't necessarily take responsibility, but said, and why they supported these actions, is that they feel that this campus is a safe space, and as they said, I'm quoting them, as students of color, the American flag triggers us for a number of reasons. And so to me, that's intellectual and political disagreement over Republican patriotism or whatever it is, but that to me, that is not where we want to be on college campus, where the American flag is a triggering thing that violates the safe space of the campus.
But we really haven't had any problems with students feeling that there's triggers in the classroom, and I feel like that's because we have a lot of open conversation. We do have safe spaces, and we do have areas for students to let their mind go free and understand these different concepts around them, but we also have to make them realize that they're only going to be there for a short time as students, and that they're going straight into the workforce usually after. So, in that workforce, I don't think that they put out a syllabus that's like, you can't plagiarize, you can't say these words, because isn't that just the adult world, where you just have to get used to things that you might not like to hear?
I think maybe labels are divided, but identities may not be, and if you have conviction, a belief, or something that identifies you, you don't want to discard that, because that's who you are. So it becomes an identity, it is a label at the same time, but at a label point, maybe it does become divisive, whereas an identity, maybe it's not.
If we don't do the work of diversity and inclusion now, and if we don't have effective dialogues, and if mainstream populations don't hear what minoritized and diverse populations are saying and respond to it, college campuses, liberal arts, institutions, privatized campuses as we know them, will cease to be relevant and will not continue to exist. So we've got to do this work now. And the feelings that people have and the pushback that people are giving, understand that minoritized populations feel this every day. Every day. And so to shut somebody's voice down, to give some pushback, think about whether or not you're using the same measuring stick when you talk about free speech for diverse populations as you are if you're a member of the mainstream.
But I actually think that the way political correctness is used today is primarily associated with the left. And things that the things that progressives have done to try to increase diversity and tolerance on college campuses, in the workplace. So I think a lot of those initiatives are what is primarily associated with political correctness. So that when you say what's happening on college campuses today with free speech in relation to political correctness, I think that is most accurately described as an accusation towards progressive policies. And my own perspective on that is to add that this tension between diversity or equal rights on college campuses, I would extend that to be an issue in the workplace as well, that tension regarding free speech and equal rights in the United States has been going on for a very, very long time. It is not limited to the time period that we associate with political correctness.
To talk about it as moral correctness would actually make the problem worse. In my mind, because it makes language a very static reality. And the truth is that language changes. And whether I would prefer to see it as an act of being sensitive or attentive to the changing reality of both people and our social conditions. So, I agree with the first speaker. I find that the language of political correctness is often used in derogatory, but as well as isolating ways that don't really help the discussion, and usually used as a way to, limit the conversation rather than foster it.
And I think it's really, really important for us. And I think that oftentimes when we're talking about these issues, we tend to talk about the coddling of students, and that, you know, students just kind of need to get themselves together and be okay and all of those kinds of things. But I also think that this is all very much a two-sided conversation, and I think this is part of what this question is getting at, in that both students and faculty, within the context, of course, of the administrative policies that are set, have a responsibility to come to the classroom ready to be engaged. And that means being willing and ready to step outside of your comfort zone, right? And certainly there's been research done within the past few years that indicates that increasingly, as Americans, we are really talking to and hanging out with and seeing people who are like us all the time. We are with people who are like us, people who are like us racially, in terms of class background, in terms of ideas, in terms of political affiliation. And I think college is that time when we have an opportunity to really make ourselves uncomfortable. But I think that opportunity is something that has to be managed carefully, both by students, but I think that faculty as well have a really unique opportunity, and I think that we should take it very seriously in being able to set up that environment in which everyone feels comfortable sharing and adding to that dialogue.
That student shouldn't feel that they can't speak because other students are going to put them down because of their beliefs or what they've gone through or what they even know. At that point, it's not too late to set a structure and say, before we start, no one should be attacked for their beliefs. Our beliefs are our experiences, what shaped us, what we've gone through, what we've seen, and what we've done. So for another student to shut down at that point, we've already missed that process. We already missed the first step, which was to set a safe space, to initiate a safe space to make sure that every student has and is aware that all is there, each individual is able to say what they feel, as long as though they're not putting other students down or dehumanizing any other student.
So when my peers are trying to tell me that a Confederate flag means nothing, it's simply a reflection of history, and my ancestors, right, were under that flag picking cotton, or being oppressed for years and years, hundreds of years, and killed as well. So that's, I think that that's a little bit, I think when people try to call that, you're coddling them, you're doing this, you're doing that, I don't know if my humanity, it should be in question here, right? Because in essence, gender is questioning humanity, that's often a conversation. So I think that some ideological differences are important to just highlight and say, like, these need to be particularly offensive because they literally threaten the person's humanity in this space and their ability in this space and their access to this space.
There's federal law that regulates speech in the workplace regarding gender and race. So Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 prohibits sexual harassment, and that is defined as, interestingly, it definitely regulates speech, but the law says conduct. That it's, unwelcome conduct of a sexual nature, and then there's another definition. But there's, in general, just the idea that the workplace is also trying to balance, equality and speech. And there's actually much less of an expectation of free speech in the workplace than there would be in our educational institutions.
A diversity director is there for the majority. You see, as a former diversity director, I get that I wake up black every day. I know how to deal with me, and I pretty much know how to deal with others like Dr. Smith. Right? Mr. Dormer, I get that. It's those of you who don't know that is what I'm there to do. I'm there to worry you. I'm there to cause dissonance for you. I'm there to teach you. They don't really need me. Do you see what I mean? And what we're finding, and they will nod in a knowing way, that the diversity directors these days are changing in terms of complexion, which has become a very positive thing on college campuses in some ways. Diversity directors are no longer just, oh, if you see a black person in the room, that's their diversity director. No, not anymore. They are more, we're finding a lot of them at our conferences that are majority women and men, who are very effective because they are able to hold up a mirror with their colleagues and brethren and say, did you hear what you said? Now let me tell you a new way to work with this dissonance that has been created on your campuses. So whilst I believe it to be a necessary evil, I think that what people have done is ghettoize the concept and think it's there for the diverse students and the diverse faculty. It's not. Those positions are there as it's constantly being in a teachable mode for the majority culture on campus.